cover stuff with grime, and then after that, the wheel starts dripping off the cover.
Were you in the new one yet?
I believe in a serious spot or the other.
I've seen photographs way back before. I don't know. Like, I've worked in the should be half cold now.
There must be a tournament of the right
thing. I think you're a lot in America.
Hello.
Was it late?
Yeah.
If I sort of do that, then your feet's just after walking out of it there.
We're watching the live stream.
Oh, are you serious?
You must be. You're probably...
So I'll put my leg in, right?
So I'm going to say that to you. Just to be honest with you.
If you come over here now, you'll see your leg. Mm-hmm.
I know, but sure.
Come on now, I'll have to...
Oh, 13 seconds.
Bloody hell.
What, you fill the queue?
That's like when out live now, people are logging. Is it
sounding off? There's four people watching.
You don't have to walk up with your
hand. Three of us probably in the council office.
Yeah. Right.
Do you use Facebook much then? Which is it?
Yeah.
I can go to Facebook, but you see the problem with Facebook, not everybody's on Facebook. So therefore people that want to log on to this wouldn't have been able to do it, but now they can log on via YouTube.
YouTube has changed everything, hasn't it?
I'll check
with it. Wasn't on
our... On your email? Either was ours. Like, that's what I have to come back to you to see how we put up a screen down there. We took one with us. We were going to do it. If we were based down there, you'd just run the cables out. Like. Now, needs must.
Sometimes add in these extras, that's the thing that you're supposed to be doing, gets
do you use them SBS cards, Mark?
I used to. I sold the camera, but I now use SBS.
All right, that's just the same as a JVC camera, but yeah.
In some of these bags,
whenever JVC contacted with these cameras, right, and over to look at them. They're the only one in our price bracket at the time.
Right.
Suitable, which is over. I asked him any chance of being able to call. Stores up in the device down the high down and as soon as you record
part of my life there, the accused part.
Okay.
Part of my life is there, the happiest part.
I guess it is.
When you go to Dublin town in 100 years or so, inquire for me in Bryan Street and what he would like to know. We were the queer one, Paul Dalton, I know. He was a queer one, I tell you. My great grandmother knew him well. He asked us a common call on him and his flat, and she gave us a thought of a young girl. Lovely Paul, no, he was dangerous. Paul Dalton, I know. I tell you, on Pembroke Road, look out for my ghost, dishevelled with shoes untied, playing through the railings with little children, whose children have long since died. We was a nice man, Paul Dalton, I know. He was a nice man, I tell you. Go into a pub and listen well, if my voice still echoes there. Ask the name what my grandfather thought, and to tell them to answer. I tell you, he had the knack of making men feel as small as the least he were, which meant as great as God had made them, but as made as it is like to there. Oh, he was a proud one, Paul, now that I know. He was a proud one, I tell you. If ever you go to Dublin town in 100 years or so, sniff for my personality. It is like an easy for now. We were the main one, Paul of the Dido. He was the main one, I tell you. I saw his name with a hot color in a book of the library. It said he had never fully achieved his potentiality. We were Paul of the Dido. He was slothful, I tell you. He knew that posterity has no use for anything but the soul. The lines that speak the passionate heart, the spirit that lives alone. Oh, he was a lonely one, Paul Dalton, I know. Yet he lived happily, I tell you. No wonder. poet, I say, would start writing verses at 18 or 20 and continue to the death. We live in a sort of bubble. We act blindly. And society is a guide for the blind, guiding us past love to marriage. We are all blind, and all too many activities take place in this bubble. Consciousness is there. Well, in 1952, I was blinder than ever. It was art. I had so much to say, and as nobody would employ me, I know to say it. Every potential employer said that I was a genius, and therefore unemployable. Horrible. Then my brother Peter said to me, I have 800 quid. Let's start a weekly paper. And when the 800 is gone, we stop. We'll have the first issue on the stand next week. So I went to the typewriter and for 13 weeks ago, made an article, poems, letters, stories for children, and every case of my unimportant diary. And I am now looking at the file of that weekly, which we call Chapter Week, which is my best autobiography, and gives an account of all the years that were around me then, and a story of the times that were living. This was during the final years of my belief in belief, and my belief in Ireland was a spiritual entity. I was out to save my country, and wrote in the first issue's editorial, why are people leaving the countryside of the town? To go to England where conditions are extremely bad.
A simple direction to you is, you know,
what they are seeking is enthusiasm for life. Attempts have been made to superimpose an artificial theory on the countryside. Amateur dramatics and all that. But these things are not indigenous. Happiness is continuity, growth. And once that chain is broken, as here, disaster follows. And as I read that piece again, I am now looking out the view window onto the sunset green of Pembroke Road. My 1952 analysis of this problem was this. As we've seen, mediocrity has never...
Sorry, Michal is putting that up there for us in an emergency.
Isn't that brilliant?
Unfortunately...
In the following issue, I was beginning to get pretty angry.
The filly coming this
said,
way... Or is it safe to
awake is in progress in this
country. But I think you finish
coming you
awake. Yes, I know things you do.
Now so I'd work with our
people. But I was nice to Eugene. We've more or less
decided that it would come. I'm going to try and determine then the mic. I would then place the mic here. So if it's a grave here at the mic, or where do you want to post the action stand within sight of the...
Rarely good family.
Well, look at here, there's no point in me saying I'm not excited. Look at it, I can't get a concept of that.
But we have because this is quite damp in the area, that the force will line up.
Yet another aspect of
this
analysis, which is still more
damp. Right, so.
And that is then to line them up in order, so no one is worried about where they come in the running order.
Yeah.
Line them up in the order that they're going to be speaking in. Standing on the concrete. The only one I'd worry about is you.
You know, I mean, you have been there in
the psychology.
So John,
after a while
it's
so if you have a map or something...
Yeah, I can't get a map, yeah.
Is it a Western map or a
Bill map or something? Discovered a controversy, but whatever. Never in 34 years had he doubted does all these graves. Never in 34 years, and then all of a sudden to stick it up now.
Have you forgot that?
No, I have my own stand there.
My
it was rain, didn't
it? Yeah.
Who owns that half a room?
Who owns that half a room?
Okay.
That's all.
You only hear everybody about it, though. The master of the state, the opening of the
road.
I
can do
the
phones and, you know, you're just standing there.
Just like I hear about it. So they said that there was somewhere for you to do
it.
The last of what United Assembly of Platitude called a
no, but it's Charlie as well, and I've trade, so look, that's really three of us, and then you as well,
we analyze
okay.
Our
okay.
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 Okay, and back out the same way then, I'd say, rather than...
But you won't be able to back out the same way. We'll
afterwards.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Rather than
20 But I can hear you.
Where are the speakers?
They're not reading, yeah.
Reading, yeah.
Here. I'm facing this way, facing that.
Okay, perfect.
Yeah.
Yes.
Walking down the
You can't have them there unless you put the mic off the path.
No, yeah. But I will do that.
Yeah, yeah. But then when you're going to get someone giving out about having a slip on the grave.
What grave? No, but it won't be on this.
Yeah. Well, let's just put the mic here.
I don't think you want it moving around.
I'm going to get Vincent now and get my car.
Follow you then?
That makes sense.
Perfect sense.
And let's go down to here.
Yeah.
It's a great engine.
Okay. I need it.
I presume we're going to take no notice of this instead.
Well, I have to take some notice of it.
But I suppose you would just keep to this half of it.
To move the stand.
The walking down this way somewhere.
Marriage. stars. Above the pines, the moon was slowly drifting. The river sighed below. The dim sierras far beyond the clifting, the minarets of snow. And I went on, and that poem was in the verge of time, before I ever thought of writing it. A strange time, too, difficult to visualize, for a man who afterwards became so deeply involved in there. How strange a thing like that happened to a man. He dabbles in something and doesn't know that it is his life. If I have of any kind during the school books, when I read, often I think of that beautiful town that is seated with the sea. I am walking through a field called Lurgan, away down towards the shady corner. It is an October evening, and all around me is a protecting fog of family life. How shall I live when the fog is blown away, and I am left alone in nature? So did I read poetry to child, and prose as a heavy education. I have something to say about literature, though, as I have remarked, we try to keep it in the background, as we want it to appeal to the large public, it seems. This, in spite of the fact that our only advertisement was a Connor Minchin, inserted by Victor Waddington for the Anime. Connor Cruz O'Brien's book, Maria Cross, was out, and I had said, under my own name, not editorial, in case, I suppose, that our public might think the whole form of our mass organization was behind it. On my individual word only. I said, oh, Maury, I can only speak as I find, and I find what Maury unfolds. I lack the godlike capacity for being interested in this crowd of troubled women. They are important to themselves and in the sight of God, but they are too much with me, like Wordsworth's word. Of George Moore, we owe several debts to George Moore. For far more than yet, not the mood of European letters in Dublin. He had less venom in him than Yeats, and he was, in spite of all his humour, a Catholic in all his points of view. I wrote about my three books, Moby Dick, Ulysses, and Gilgamesh. I said, the great merit of Melville's book is that it enlarges the world, brings us through the eyes of Yeats into the expansive world of the imagination. The world is enlarged. We can find the same expansiveness in a small field. To get to know even a small field is a lifetime's exploration. I remember myself standing at the top of the hill, now looking east towards Swansea Burg. I sometimes promised that one day would be to that distant place, 2 miles away, which I remembered walking to in childhood. But other places called, I owed a visit to the corner where there were stepping stones across the street at the junction of 4 fields. Part of my life was spent there, the happiest part. On many a summer day, I was standing in that corner taking a rest after cutting bolters and ragwood with an old sign. That would be the month of July.
If they are coming down here and they read to here.
And yet how it breaks the heart to contemplate that time.
That's a pickup. That doesn't mean.
No one man knows what lies ahead.
I don't want to, Mike.
No one knows what causes death. Yes, my death, these things have come to me. But it was
not.
I can feel the heart someday tear from the bed.
No.
I can feel the wild strand growing from it. Those thieves are still there, and the deep sunken stream that gave us so much trouble is still there. And they're used to the hedge of the plain of Loud, the plain of the Himalayas, right out to the Irish Sea and Yard. If only I could go back and be a little more awake and aware. There's no going back. The happiness of that life is consistent in its unconscious. When we are unconscious, we are close to the tavern. Bang on, we have to shut our eyes. 38. Yeah. Moby Dick.
Yeah.
It's an evocation of the sea and that of consciousness. It was written one sample out. I can say that however bad it may be, even as often as the alleged child to whom it's been told things, but after that awful genre of children which appear to be so popular these days, these are unimaginative whimsy, usually written by stupid women, but also some by stupid men. And no child could overcome so foul a blow early in life. It's only such children have been written by dead poets such as Anderson and Gray. These little stories of mine were called Tales of a Horrid Father, and this is one of them. The Big Toes. One morning as Joe was lying in bed with his feet out of the bed coat, hardy morning, said the Big Toe. Joe was in an awful state. He wasn't able to think for a few minutes. He pulled the clothes over his head for a while and tried to pretend that he didn't hear the Big Toe talk. In the end, he peeped down, and there were the two big toes, not talking to each other. "We want you to let us go home," said the first Big Toe. "We don't belong to your feet at all. We won't be happy unless you let us go." "But how can I let you go?" said Joe. "I can't cut off a big toe." "Get the razor and cut it off. I won't be sorry," said the second big toe. "It won't hurt you." So Joe got up and gets the safety razor blade, and he cuts off his two big toes. The two toes began to grow eyes and a small pair of legs, and in a few minutes they had half an inch. They shook hands with Joe and went out the door and down the stairs. Joe had a wife in the bed, wondering what it'd be. There was no dream. When he tried to get out of bed to put on his boots, he was found he was short and too big to.
He
told
his wife that he had not got on a bicycle and raced down the road up on the toes. As he found him at the
kicking.
Right between themselves.
They're doing a live stream
of the video. That's not my end of it.
No, I know.
To settle the question, they had started to come back. The woman tried to stop them.
What are you putting into this?
Microphone.
Just that I know, like, what sort of a, like, can it create a bit of a distance?
See, the trouble is, the people are, people are doing the same thing here.
Yeah, we tried to do it, but not be mic stuff up in front of them.
They're going to be standing here, and then when they finish the meeting,
Thank you.
borrow the loan of Charles the Yard to go to Dundalk and borrow it. For I'll hold the evening before the market, and make thou that night of mocker. We healed up to cart before the door, we took the harness inside, the straw stopped saddle, the broken breeching, with bits of burrow and quiet time. The winters that had no choke band, the colour of the rain. Broadway, London town, I named her several names, until a world comes to life, mornings and silent fog, and the god of imagination walking in a book on fog. And sometimes I am sorry when the grass is growing over the stones, in quiet hollows, and the cocks would leave the cross for his dark path. But I am not the voice of country fellows, who now are standing voice of head and talking, or torments of the tailors or young corn, or tall bags tip for drinkers. The impeach is still hawking, his coloured comb scarred and in the horn. Upon a headland by a whinny hedge, a hare sits looking down a leaf, napped for him. There's an old plough upside down on a weedy ridge. And someone has shown it home a sad out of that childhood country, what fools try to find China's love and life to try. A year ago I fell in love with the functional ward of a chest hospital. Square cubicles in a row, plain concrete, wash basins and art lovers' home. Not counting how the fellow with the next bed snowed. But nothing whatever is by love debarred. The common and banal are each alone. The corridor led to a stairway and below was the inexhaustible pension of a gravel yard. This is what love does, maybe. The Rialto Bridge, the main gate that was bent by a heavy lorry. The seat at the back of a shed that was a sun trap. Naming these things as the light and its pledge. For we must accord love's mystery without claptrap. Snatch out of time the passionate transitory. For Jim Larkin died February 1947. Elegy written in March 1947. Not that public words now can his greatness told to children, for he was more than labour agitator, mob orator, the flashing fiery sword, merely was witness to the sun rising. Cried Larkin, look, the fields are producing for you and the trees. And beyond are not the self-stocked land, but seas rolling excitement in God's courtyard. When the full moon's in the river, the ghost of bread must not be in all your weary trudgings home. The masts of one stag galleys will become for a forest under the north's glittering cloud, and the rusty gantry's the heroic head of man the magician whom the gods endow. It was thus I heard Jim Larkin shout above the crowd who would have turned aside from the day's shocking reality, their morphine pride. It is the fogs of unhope that would have moved. The smoke, the drop of the newspaper story. And with mouths open, they were glad to stare. Not at a blackboard.
It's still morning time, is it? It's still morning time.
What is that? Is it?
And the mill race heavy with the lambs and blood, curling over the wheel.
From the north, from the north.
right?
And the hysteric laughter repeated everywhere. Knight and a few dying cards are shuffled again. Maguire spends his legs over the impotent cinders that wake no man of
his.
And he hardly looked at the sea when the card is drunk.
His
sister tightens her legs and prisons up. Like the wink of an eyelid.
They're heavily advertised.
Applause.
Oh, I dare say that.
Living in the country, part one.
Well, I presume I'm a politician.
But the warm summer of that landmark in a child's mind.
Good job in the
village. Sunlight
and both grass.
Green grass or some rail with milk. The humming of wild bees.
Where are we standing?
Seeing that you're standing here.
Okay. And do we have a microphone? No.
Yeah, stands are going to be there.
Okay, grand, okay. Grand, okay. So are we standing over there and then coming over here?
I'm coming down this way and then standing over there.
Standing over there. Okay.
How are you keeping? You're looking great. Yeah.
How are you?
I'm good. I'm in RTE now.
Please walking across the crest of the hill and
thy rhyme, cavorting on mine high city, and beyond there, crowns of the upward terror is our rational face. Oh, dance with pity, stop thy outrage thee, cry by thy timorous paces, stop thee behind yon page by, paging me. I had a very pleasant joy, thank you sincerely for giving me my madness thine, for fear me behind yon page by, paging me. Give us another thought, he said, or they will think your muse is dead. Another middle-aged departure or authority from the train of our joy. Bring out a lucrative as you can, to let them see you a living man, whose comic spirit is untamed, though sadness for little claims, the precedence, and tenderness you pull your push, and wondered if old cunning silence might not be a bitter death of poetry. You have not got the countenance to hold the angle of pretense, that angry ring of lucre,
God cannot judge us unless we stay in the
We must not touch the amount of material. We must not daydream tomorrow's judgment. God must be allowed to surprise us. We have sinned magnificently with this anticipation. Let us lie down again, deep in anonymous humility, and God may find us warm material for his hand. He was a queer one, I tell you. My great-grandmother knew him well. He asked the common call on him and his lads to the support of a young girl, looking for a dog that I knew. He was dangerous, I tell you. On Pembroke Road, look out for my ghost, disheveled with shoes untied, playing through the railings with little children. Children of long since died. He was a nice man, far more than I knew. He was a nice man, I tell you. Go into a pub and listen well. If my voice still echoes there, ask the name for my grandfather's son, and to tell them to answer well. We was eccentric, far more than I knew. He was eccentric, I tell you. He had the knack of making men be as small as of anywhere, which meant as great as God had made them, but as made as it is like to there. We was a proud one, far now that I know. He was a proud one, I tell you. If ever you go to Dublin town, in 100 years or so, still for my proud narrative, in the vanity of him or now, we was a big one, far now that I know. I saw his name with 100 others in a book in the library. It said he had never fully achieved his potential. He was so good, Paul, not I know. He was so good, I tell you. He knew the prosperity he had known, but anything but the soul. And I was a thief, and I should have been a fool.
I was not in the room, and I realized Yes, Eugene, up this way.
Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, you're welcome here today. Now, a graveyard is a sacred and a spiritual place. And while we have a veritable Parnassus of readers today, we will ask that you will refrain from applauding when they are finished speaking, and any applause that we will have will be later on down in the hall. A spiritual experience, and this is the 50th anniversary of Patrick Kavanagh's death. Patrick Kavanagh lies here. He lies here with his wife Catherine. Just beside him are his sisters Annie and Mary, and just back here behind in the ferns is his brother Peter, his sacred keeper. Further on towards the centre are where his father and mother lie, James and Bridget. So we can reflect on all of that as we are here. Now, there are many people here who have relations in this graveyard, and this is, appropriately, the month of November, when the dead are remembered. And now, without anything else to say, I will ask the readers who will come up in the order that they know has been prepared.
O stony grey soil of Monaghan, the laugh from my love you teaved. You took the gay child of my passion and gave me your clod conceived. You clogged the feet of my boyhood, and I believed that my stumble had the stride and poise of Apollo, and his voice my thick-tongued mumble. You told me the plough was immortal. Oh, green life-conquering plough, your mantle strained, your coulter blunted in the smooth lay field of my brow. You sang on steaming dunghills a song of coward's brood. You perfumed my clothes with weaselitch. You fed me with swinish food. You flung a ditch on my vision of beauty, love and truth. Oh, stony grey soil of Monaghan, you burgled my bank of youth. Lost the long hours of pleasure. All the women that loved young men. Oh, can I still stroke the monster's back or write with unpoisoned pen his name in these lonely verses, or mention the dark fields where the first gay flight of my lyric got caught in a peasant's prayer. Mullinhenge, Dromeryl, Black Shankle. Wherever I turn, I see in the stony grey soil of Monaghan dead loves that were born for me.
Givna my water. Nis muinia martis tu the leaf fwin crae lioch sa relig y muinachon. Chiam hu, ig siw lat sias lana na gran piblog, the Valach higgin slashun, no the Valach sonna higgin dara hafrin, gonach sa tauru. Cotton to lum is jer. Na jarment arc ni na mehiach, da hirula da ra is an a hain na hangel kelch. Smeenia mart, tu eg shul amara kin da kirkia glas an vehev, ko hamlan da huevnes, ko lan da gus. Bulamunch gan kinya la kele eg kionawala. La eni is a near than the maragi or fad the yanu. Higlin shul la kele, idur na shoppy is na stanini. Seer a srajna urharaka na smuinchorachta. O neil tu id the leaf when crail yach marta tranona foran an ish. Agus tam when she carnu na gruach fair. A gunya hollis na gyali is tu a myongaira an niasarin gashiri. In memory of my mother, I do not think of you lying in the wet clay of a Monaghan graveyard. I see you walking down a lane among the poplars, or on your way to the station, or happily going to second mass on a summer Sunday. You meet me and you say, don't forget to see about the cattle. Among your earthiest words, the angels stray. And I think of you walking along a headland of green oats in June, so full of repose, so rich with life. And I see us meeting at the end of town on a fair day by accident after. The bargains are all made and we can talk together through the shops and the stalls and markets, free in the oriental streets of thought. Oh, you are not lying in the wet clay, for it is harvest evening now, and we are piling up the ricks against the moonlight, and you smile up at us eternally.
Come dance with Kitty Stubbing. No, no, no. I know I was not important as I moved through the colourful country. I was but a single item in the picture, the namer, not the beloved. O tedious man with whom no gods commingle, beauty, who has described beauty? Once upon a time I had a myth that was a lie, but it served. Trees walking across the crests of hills and my rhyme cavorting on mile-high stilts and the unnerved crowds looking up with terror in their rational faces. Oh, dance with Kitty Stubbling, I outrageously cried out of sense to them, while their timorous paces stumbled behind Job's page boy, paging me. I had a very pleasant journey, thank you sincerely, for giving me my madness back, or nearly.
They laughed at one I loved, the triangular hill that hung under the big fort. They said that I was bounded by the white thorn hedges of the little farm and did not know the world. But I knew that love's doorway to life is the same doorway everywhere. Ashamed of one I loved, I flung her from me and called her a ditch, although she was smiling at me with violets. And now I am back in her briary arms. The dew of an Indian summer morning lies on bleached potato stalks. What age am I? I do not know what age I am. I am no mortal age. I know nothing of women, nothing of cities. I cannot die unless I move outside these white thorn hedges.
Thank you. Written as an epilogue to a series of lectures given at University College Dublin. Particularly if you yourself have been left, as they call it, on the shelf. All God's chillin' got wings, so the black Alabaman sings. Down Grafton Street on Saturdays, don't grieve like Marcus Aurelius, who said that though he grew old and grey, the people of the Appian Way were always the same pleasant age, 24 on average. I can never help reflecting of coming back in another century from now and feeling comfortable at a buzzing coffee table. The students in 2056 with all their old eternal tricks. The thing that I most glory in is this exciting, unvarying quality that withal is completely original. For what it teaches is just this: we are not alone in our loneliness. Others have been here and known griefs we thought our special own, problems that we could not solve, lovers that we could not have, pleasures that we missed by inches. Come, I'm beginning to get pretentious, beginning to message forth instead of expressing how glad I am to have lived to feel the radiance of a holy hearing audience and delivered God's commands into those caressing hands. My personality, that's to say, all that is mine exclusively. What wisdom's ours, if such there be, is a flavor of personality. I thank you, and I say how proud I am that I have been, by fate allowed, to stand here, having the joyful chance to claim my inheritance. For most have died the day before the opening of that holy door.
There will be bluebells growing under the big trees, and you will be there, and I will be there in May. For some other reason, we will both have to delay the evening in Dunshaughlin to please some imagined relation, so both of us came to walk through that plantation. We will be interested in the grass, in an old bucket hoop, in the ivy that weaves green incongruity among dead leaves. We will put on surprise at carts that pass, only sometimes looking sideways at the bluebells in the plantation, and never frighten them with too wild an exclamation. We will be wise. We will not let them guess that we are watching them, or they will pose a mere facade like boys caught out in virtue's naturalness. We will not impose on the bluebells in that plantation too much of our desire's adulation. We will have other loves, or so they'll think, the primroses, or the ferns, or the briars, or even the rusty paling wires, or the violets on the sunless sorrel bank. Only as an aside, the bluebells in the plantation will mean a thing or two to our dark contemplation. We'll know love little by little, glance by glance. Ah, the clay under these roots is so brown. We'll steal from heaven while God is in the town. I caught an angel smiling in a chance look through the tree trunks of the plantation as you and I walked slowly to the station.
Memory of my father. Every old man I see reminds me of my father when he had fallen in love with death one time when sheaves were gathered. That man I saw in Gardiner Street stumble on the curb was one. He stared at me half-eyed. I might have been his son. And I remember the musician faltering over his fiddle in Bayswater, London. He too set me the riddle. Every old man I see in October-coloured weather seems to say to me, I was once your father.
Father Matt, in the dim corners in the side seats, faces gather, lit up now and then by a guttering candle and the ghost of day at the window. A secret lover is saying three Hail Marys that she who knows the ways of women will bring Kathleen O'Hara. He names her home to him. Ironic fate, Kathleen herself is saying three Hail Marys to her who knows the ways of men to bring somebody else home to her. Oh, may he love me. What is the Virgin Mary now to do? From a confessional, the voice of Father Matt's absolving rises and falls like a briar in the breeze. As Father Matt walked home, Venus was in the western sky, and there were voices in the hedges. God the gay is not the wise. Take your choice. Take your choice. Called the breeze through the bridge's eye. The domestic virgin and her child, or Venus with her ecstasy.
Advent. We have tested and tasted too much, lover. Through a chink too wide there comes in no wonder. But here, in the Advent-darkened room, where the dry black bread and the sugarless tea of penance will charm back the luxury of a child's soul, we'll return to doom the knowledge we stole but could not use. And the newness that was in every stale thing when we looked at it as children, the spirit-shocking wonder in a black slanting Ulster hill, or the prophetic astonishment in the tedious talking of an old fool, will awake for us and bring you and me to the yard gate to watch the whins and the bog holes, cart tracks, old stables where time begins. Oh, after Christmas, we'll have no need to go searching for the difference that sets an old phrase burning. We'll hear it in the whispered argument of a churning, or in the streets where the village boys are lurching. And we'll hear it among decent men too, who barrow dung in gardens under trees, wherever life pours ordinary plenty. Won't we be rich, my love and I, and please God we shall not ask for reason's payment, the why of heartbreaking strangeness in dreeping hedges, nor analyze God's breath in common statement. We have thrown into the dustbin the clay-minted wages of pleasure, knowledge, and the conscious hour, and Christ comes with a January flower.
Thank you, and now Tadhg O'Dinkeen will play a piece for us on the Illan pipes, and while that is happening, members of the Kavanagh family will lay a wreath on the grave. Thank you, everybody, for your concentration. And now we will move back to the Patrick Kavanagh Centre, and there we will have some formal speeches, because there is a civic end to this whole ceremony as well. But thank you for your concentration, and thank you for taking part. And I hope that some of us that will be here, us is an interesting word, but looking in front, we have school children here, and they will be able to remember this perhaps in another 50 years. Now, we got a lovely few minutes here to do it, and so if we can go and leave quietly. It's a graveyard, and apart from that, graveyards are dangerous enough places to be walking around. So thank you very much, everybody.